Time now, Swati, for our guest, Mayuresh Joshi, who's of course a fund manager, Angel Broking, to join us. Mayuresh, wonderful to have you on the show with us. We've been, of course, talking about how the markets are looking at the moment. What are some of the trades that you're looking at very carefully? Where do you think we're going to be going from here in the short term?
Afternoon, Fatima. Clearly, I think after the exuberance that we witnessed post the UP election verdict, the markets did exhibit a very strong momentum on the upside. But again, I think the cognizance is getting recognized in respect of earnings panning out. So earnings clearly are going to struggle at least for the next couple of quarters. And if one really expects the earnings recovery to take place in the second half of the coming fiscal year, that can provide a substantial re-rating to the markets. Secondly, I think the private capex cycle, which has been long talked about, has been stalled for some reasons. And again, I think the capacity constraints that we're probably seeing across industries, specifically in the manufacturing value chain, I think their quarter four is something where some amount of respite might come through. The government is pushing through on their capex program with substantial allocations done on the capital expenditure part for this budget year. But largely, again, I think these two parameters and a re-rating thereof is going to hold the markets. GST implementation will be key. A little bit inflationary in the first year. And again, I think what the hit in terms of revenue losses the center takes is something to be taken a look at as well. But largely, again, I think the domestic factors should start showing signs of revival over the next 2 to 3 quarters, specifically in the case of earnings. And the global headwinds probably will keep on persisting. What Trump does with his policies is largely unknown at this point of time. And we'll largely be getting over with a couple of events. The Netherlands election is out. The French elections will be out. Eurozone still looks a little bit on the soft and tepid side. But largely, again, I think the earnings will do the talking. So I think it's going to be more stock specific, in my opinion. Markets might consolidate around the current levels unless we see earnings revival, which I don't see in the next 2 quarters. But again, I think remain positive on the markets with a 2-year view.
Mayuresh, fair point, and I think you did say that this will consolidate for some time, but 9100 is what it's touched and went close to 9200 today. 9050 is where it's hovering. What is the level that you think it will sort of settle down to, one? And two, you did talk about the domestic story coming back on track in 2 to 3 quarters. We've been hearing this for last maybe 2 years. Every quarter, you know, the expectations are risen. And you know, one hopes that after a couple of quarters things will improve. What is the basis of your optimism this time around, saying after a couple of quarters you think things will look better and earnings will be better this time around?
So, afternoon, Swati. Yes, you're absolutely correct. I think for the past 2 to 3 years, we've been optimistic that the second half of each financial year will probably see some respite in terms of earnings picking up. And that has not happened. And this is more to do with how the global conditions were behaving at that point of time. And again, the oversupply in terms of capacities that had got built in over the past few years. Now, as spending starts trickling through in a very sustained manner, specifically on the government side, whether that's infrastructure, whether that's power, whether that's ports, whether that's roads, my own sense is that the pickup in infrastructure activities will probably lay a trigger to a lot of companies catering within the segment itself. As manufacturing activity picks up, I think the numbers that you'll probably see on the IIP front will be a lot more sustained. Secondly, I think in terms of the base earnings that we'll probably be looking at for the second half of this fiscal, in the coming fiscal, and the second half of the fiscal gone by, I think the base itself is going to be a little bit smaller. So I think the earnings will look larger on that base itself. But if one really talks in terms of inflation staying around 5-6%, you're probably talking about nominal GDP of around 5-6%. I think the real GDP growth can be much higher. And that's the base for earnings growing at 14-15% for the better part of the coming fiscal. And if that probably sustains, along with all the government measures in terms of tackling asset quality issues, the NP mess that we're probably looking at over the next few quarters, the credit growth which has been languishing, I think that should pick up meaningfully as well. So I think all these elements should start coming together, hopefully by Q3, Q4 of the coming fiscal. And if that happens, the earnings growth of 14-15% should sustain. FY19, I think, should see greater impetus happening because of the capex spend on the private side, which is expected to come through in Q4 of this fiscal or Q1 and the first half of the next fiscal. So largely, again, I think these factors should hold Indian corporates in good stead, and corporate India should probably start seeing better times ahead. So I think the enthusiasm probably stays at this point of time. And if this works out, I think the re-rating can probably happen on the PE multiples that the Sensex is enjoying at this point of time. Though I think richly valued at this point of time on a one-year forward basis, if earnings come for the next 2 to 3 quarters, that justification can very well be justified.
Maharish, I take what you're saying, and interesting points that you make about how we could potentially be really looking at some turnaround activity as well as a clearer focus on FY19. Just before we get into the latest, I want your opinion on telecom, because there's been a consolidation that was obviously much expected in this space. There is... I guess still a lot that needs to be settled when it comes to policy as well as implementation of service. If you were to place your bets on the telecom sector, or I guess if you had to sort of strategize as to what you're holding on to right now, what would your what is your advice to investors at this stage?
So again, Fatima, I think the telecom industry is going through consolidation. The merger of Idea Vodafone, which has come through, will create a behemoth in terms of 390 million odd subscribers, SMS share in excess of 35-36% odd, the revenue market share close to 40-41% odd, and there'll be four large players largely in the market. Now, whether that suffices, the requirements of data pricing actually going up or pricing pressures still continuing on incumbents, my own sense is that the latter would probably still work out over the next year, to say the least. With Jio coming out with its plans and the other operators crashing down on their existing plans to probably retain their subscriber base, that's definitely going to have a telling effect in terms of how the top line EBITDA and the bottom line performance for existing telecom incumbents is going to be. Couple that up with the kind of spectrum payout liabilities that they still have to dish out, and again the operating expenses in terms of upgrades of their network costs. That is a significant element which will probably take sheen of the cash flows that they generate. The operating debt to EBITDA levels, I think it's pretty high for all these companies as well. So again, looking at the deal that Idea Vodafone came out around 6.2-6.3 EBITDA, close to fair valuations of around 6.5, even if one assumes tower sales to come through in terms of the standalone business and 11.15% sold by Idea in the joint venture that it holds in Indus. I think it's largely factoring in the positives to come through from that segment. So I think pricing pressure should continue in terms of data intensity. I think whether that offsets the kind of fall that we've seen in data realization prices, 17-18 paise per megabyte for Bharti Airtel in the quarter gone by, around 16.5 paise per megabyte for Idea, which is significantly lower 4 to 8 quarters back what these companies enjoy. So I think the pressure on margins will very well continue, and I think Jio is going to take a chunk away in terms of both the SMS and RMS share. So you have to pick and choose within the space itself. My own sense is that if Jio comes out with better than expected numbers out of the 10 crore subscriber base that it has got, and if one assumes a base case scenario of 5 crore, the ARPUs will be significantly higher for the plan that it has got of 303 and the base plan of 149, of 172 that Bharti enjoys, of 160 that Idea enjoys. And again, that does create dent in terms of operators' profitability. So I think Jio's capex is almost over in terms of their core as well as the telecom capex. If incrementally they can add subscribers on a sustained manner, the first half of FY18 will have a very interesting time for Jio as a standalone telecom operator as well as its core businesses of refining and petchem. So I think Reliance is something that I'll remain optimistic about, Fatima.
Right. It is going to be an interesting trend in the telecom space that we'll watch out. Just hang in there, because now let's focus on this space as we are talking about it. Having kept its 42% stake in Indus Towers outside of the merger with Idea Cellular, Vodafone, which has been trying to sell its stake in the company, is now hoping that three partners in this company will sit around the table and take a call to monetize the stake. Piyush Jain is joining us with more details on the Vodafone Group's plans for this asset sale. Piyush, Vodafone has been trying, of course, we know, for over a year now to sell its stake in Indus and has not found any buyer for the stake. In fact, in my conversation with the global CEO Vodafone, he said that, you know, talks are on and they're not ruling out private players, private equity players and so on. Post this deal, what is the company now hoping to do? Does this deal provide any impetus for its buyer for its Indus stake?
That's right. So over the last many quarters, Vodafone Group has been actually contemplating what sort of strategy they should deploy in the Indian market, because the Indian operations, they have not been actually successful to give out cash to the Vodafone Group as a parent. Now, on the same lines, actually, if you look in terms of Indus Towers configuration, the shareholding, Vodafone actually has about 42% stake. The Idea has 11% stake. Airtel again has 42% stake. So if you think the merged entity would be having more than 50% shareholding, until now, all the three operators, they actually have managed shareholdings in a way that no single operator has actually more than 50% shareholding. And that's actually very important, very interesting to see how the three operators actually are able to sit across the table and decide the shareholding between them, because now there will be actually two operators. One will be the merged entity, the Vodafone Idea combination, and then the Bharti Airtel. Also, let's remember, we have also heard from the Vodafone Group global CEO that they actually intend to monetize tower assets before the merger actually gets closed. And when we say closure, it means all approvals, they are in place and the merger becomes effective. So it is actually very interesting, because in this merger, Vodafone's 42% stake, that is actually outside of the combination, which means Vodafone, if actually decides to monetize the stake, the entire money is going to go to the parent company and not to the combination. So if you look in terms of the merged entity would be having only 11% stake in the Indus Towers, and the rest all will be the standalone tower contribution, which is roughly around 30,000 sites, 15,000 each from both Idea and Vodafone.
Piyush, I was just going to ask you about while we're talking about monetizing, with Voda's 42% stake that we see Indus Towers outside that deal, what exactly are the plans when it comes to combining those tower assets? Can you just take us through that in detail?
Yeah, sure. Actually, what basically we learn now is that Vodafone actually and the Idea, the combination, the merged entity, the plans actually are to cut the mobile sites, those sites which actually are the third-party sites. So as we know, if in the merger and acquisition, if you actually are combining two large companies, the first question comes is, what is the synergy? And for the synergy, actually, they will like to actually cut across all the costs which are duplication, or basically both are actually incurring the same cost and they would like to actually combine them. So in that regard, actually, the third party sites would be the first choice. And what we learn is actually the merger entity intends to actually cut down the mobile sites by about 20%, which is almost 54,600 sites. At present, they almost have 2,73,000 GSM sites, and between that it's about 189,000 3G and 4G sites. Also, let's remember, the Indus Towers has been investing very actively in the market on the sites and new deployment. In fact, they have been actually investing in the green sites. So again, on one side, the Indus Towers is expanding, in which both entities have stake. On the other side, their own need actually, once they merge, for using the third-party sites would go down. And all the analyst community, the investor community, they actually want the synergies to be very large, because if the synergies are not large, then perhaps the gains from this merger are going to become small and small. And that's why we have seen there has not been much exuberance once the merger was announced on the stock price, because the quantum of synergy basically has been very less, very low as per the analyst expectations. And that's why it's very important in terms of equipment, IT systems, tower sites, sales offices, a lot of cost cutting should be there.
All right, Piyush, thank you very much for putting that in perspective. So that's one space which is very clearly being watched. But pharma is another sector that is, of course, under radar, and there's a lot of developments that are happening. USFDA, of course, being the big trigger. Mayuresh, let me come to you to understand, what are your top bets in pharma space with what's been happening? We've seen the sector not perform as well last, this year. How is it looking for FY18, if I may ask, and what are your top bets in that space?
So Swati, again, FY16 largely plagued in terms of the FDA concerns that the entire sector largely faced. And largely, again, I think the remedial and the remediation costs and timelines do extend beyond 3 to 6 quarters. If one really goes by this timeline premise, you're probably looking at ANDA approvals getting delayed, and there are every chances that if 483s are converted into import alerts, you've probably got a longer elongated time period in which your earnings take a hit. Having said that, I think the other headwinds in the form of pricing pressures in terms of what will happen with the repealment of Obamacare and the border tax that Trump is talking about might also have a say in terms of how things panned out. But largely, again, I think if one remains selective within the space itself, my own sense is that pharma stocks selectively do offer attractive entry opportunities. To cite an example, I think Alkem Labs is something that I continue to like. Domestic business is almost 73-odd%. U.S. business is 20% of its overall top line, and the other markets contribute the rest. Largely, again, I think it's a number one player in the anti-infective market, the number three player in the gastrointestinal and pain analgesics market. It's got 3.6% domestic formulation market share, 7.9% overall prescription market share in India. And largely, again, I think even if you see the kind of issues that a lot of pharma companies are facing, it is largely protected because of the domestic exposure that it has got. Secondly, I think even in terms of the FDA concerns that was raised on one of its plants, it's hardly a 1% impact on its EPS. Third, in fact, in terms of the NLEM impact that it can have on the domestic formulations business, it's again an impact of hardly a percent on the EPS. So again, I think expecting strong top line, bottom line growth to the tune of 18.5-23.5% for Alkem over the next 2 years, margins to be maintained between 19-20-odd%, and easily the company can report an EPS of around 90-92-odd rupees for FY19. So I think if I have to pick and choose to safeguard myself, both in terms of US FDA concerns as well as the exposure to the US markets in a substantial manner, I think Alkem probably fits the bill, at least at this point of time.
I understand what you're saying, Mayuresh, about Alkem and how it's poised. But just to go back to that larger issue we've been talking about in terms of regulatory sort of developments around pharma companies, let's bring in a Dr. Reddy's, because I can see that it's been trading under pressure. This is after the US FDA has issued a Form 483 with 13 observations for that Dwada plant. Brokers, however, seem to be keeping faith with this pharma major. Just seeing that the current dip is perhaps an opportunity for buying. The person, of course, who's going to be telling us more about what the brokerages are making out of the news is Hiral. I understand that she is joining us now. Hiral, just take us through what we are hearing from brokerages in terms of how they're really keeping the faith in DRL at this stage.
So overall, we have two of them which have given out reports. You have a Morgan Stanley. What they are saying is that they would stay equal weight on the counter, and they have a target price of 2,909. As we know that the FDA had re-inspected Dr. Reddy's Dwada site between the period of 27th of February to the 8th of March, and they did issue 13 observations. Dwada, if you go to see, is almost equivalent to $150 million worth of U.S. sales, and is one of the three facilities which have received a warning letter back then in November 2015. Now, three sites cumulatively, I'm talking about Miryalaguda, Srikalakulam, as well as Dwada, account for almost $250 million in product sales, which is approximately 12% of the total revenues. And if you talk about where U.S. business is concerned, it has around 25% exposure. Now, the notable products which are at risk are Glivec as well as Copaxone. So these are the two products which will remain at risk as per what Morgan Stanley is stating. And the observations is expected to delay the remediation by a few quarters, and it may result in escalation as well. Now, at first, if you go to see, if you read the 483, it sounded pretty much strict. However, a Srikalakulam inspection is expected to happen in the next few days. The remain equal weight on the stock on the back of no visibility on major product launches. And there are expected to be near-term earning challenges as well as per on the back of the FDA issues. Now, we have a Bank of America Merrill Lynch, which has a slightly different stance from here. What they are saying is that the strong pipeline is likely to drive U.S. growth despite the regulatory hurdles that Dr. Reddy's has been facing. They're expecting the EPS to rise a little less than two times despite the cut due to the adverse WISAC Form 483. They continue to maintain their buy rating on Dr. Reddy's, and what they are expecting is around 15 to 20 new launches per year, which does, you know, form a strong pipeline for the counter. And they've cut their FY18 and 19 earnings EPS by around 28% and 14% respectively. They've even gone ahead and cut the target price on the counter to the tune of almost $3,200. And overall, they're expecting the warning letter resolution to get further delayed. Maybe it might come in at the end of FY18. And they're expecting Copaxone launch in the first quarter of FY19. Apart from that, what they are saying is Dr. Reddy's also has ample time to see any site transfers in case of any delay in resolution. So that's going to be one positive that might work in favor of Dr. Reddy's. Secondly, the strong U.S. growth is also likely despite the regulatory check, and they're not seeing expecting any further downside from current valuations because they've already gone low. So overall, it's a very mixed stance that is coming, that yes, this is an issue in terms of a warning letters is concerned, but a comeback is expected soon.
All right, Hiral, thanks very much for putting that in perspective. The stock is up almost close to that 0.8% or 0.8%, and that is the one that is being talked about. And he will, of course, put that in perspective on why and what are the observations of US FDA. But brokerage is clearly keeping the faith in the stock. The other stock, let's pull that up, Delta Corp. That's in focus. The stock has gained over 5% in trade ahead of its board meeting, and this board meeting is to consider fundraising plans by the company. Motilal Oswal has also initiated coverage with buy rating for the stock. Piyush is joining us with more details on this crucial board meeting and how it's critical for the company and the brokerage report on the same. Piyush.
Well, let's start with what the Motilal Oswal is trying to say in the report. Now, they actually have initiated the report in Delta Corp, which means they've started covering the company. Now, what's more important is the price target is 229 rupees, which is a good 30% upside from what the stock is trading right now. And what they're saying is the Delta Corp actually enjoys favorable odds, which implies they actually have the first mover advantage in an industry which has just started to grow. The Indian gaming industry is roughly 0.1% of the global gaming industry. The global gaming industry is around $180 billion, while the Indian industry is roughly $150 million. And Delta Corp enjoys a very good advantage because it has started first. It has about 6 casinos, 5 are operational, 3 as offshore Goa casinos, 1 in Sikkim and 1 in Daman. So the Daman is actually the trigger which Motilal Oswal is actually watching up. The Daman is an integrated onshore casino, and they believe that Daman actually will have more footfalls than Goa because it is integrated in nature and also onshore casino. And what is actually why it's very significant is that Daman casino is going to contribute about 1200 capacity to the overall capacity, which means now actually the gaming slots will increase from 1700 to 3000, which is very good in terms of the revenue trigger. Also, they're saying that apart from what casinos we're talking about, Delta is also entering the click world. As they say, it has recently acquired the Adda52.com. So what they say is that perhaps it could not be the big trigger right now, but a lot of revenue, a lot of spending is actually moving towards internet, and that's why this will prove to be another new avenue of growth for Delta Corp. The growth expectations actually will tell you how Motilal Oswal is very bullish on the stock. The revenue average revenue growth for the next 2 years is expected to be 35%. PAT growth is expected to be 62%, and they believe that return on equity should be improving from 9% to 17% by 2019. This primarily actually can be established only on one fact, is that once the licenses are in place, the facilities are already operational or ready to be operated, then the fixed cost is almost the same. So as the footfall start increasing, the margins, the profitability starts improving. And that's what actually is driving the profitability and enthusiasm for the stock for Motilal Oswal. In terms of fundraising, it's very important because as the fundraising actually happens, the balance sheet gets lightened up, Delta Corp actually can look towards establishing more casinos and increasing more capacities.
All right, Piyush, thanks a lot for taking us through all of that. Mayuresh, of course, when Piyush was busy talking to us about Delta Corp, I kept thinking about being on holiday and in casinos. But just to come back to reality, Delta Corp, of course, is the largest operator, as we know, of the organized gaming market in India. I understand it's the only listed operator with access to those capital markets. We've talked about their efforts to go in for fundraising. But is this a sector that you look at all? Any thoughts on it?
No, not really. But again, I think the sector that I'm probably liking will be the industrial consumer sector. And within that, I think the abrasives and ceramic market is looking very, very interesting at this point of time. Obviously, I think if one goes by the premise of top line improving for these companies, as they've gone through a very bad patch in terms of how the top line growth has been very, very meager in terms of a higher single digit kind of a growth. If that starts improving, which I feel with orders coming through specifically in terms of the abrasives and ceramics market, I think it should start holding up their margins as well. Secondly, I think within this space itself, if you look at companies like a Grindwell Norton or a Coromandel Universal, they almost account for 50% of the overall market size of almost 3,000 odd crores. They've got a significant say in that. And within the space itself, I think if you look at the debt equity component, very marginal debt on the books of Grindwell Norton. It's almost 8 odd crores, so it's almost a virtual debt-free company. It's a very strong parentage. Saint Gobain, which is a market leader in the abrasives field, both bonded as well as coated abrasives abroad. Thirdly, I think within the space itself, Grindwell probably holds out in terms of its automobile exposure, and there I think volume growth has been substantially higher on a year-on-year basis and would continue to do so, in my opinion. And the silicon carbide grains is where its pricing prowess still remains. So I think the operating margin staying at 16.5% might be a reality, as the management is indicating at this point of time. So all the parameters are probably working for them. Expected top line to grow, the asset turnover, the sweating of their assets expected to improve over the next 2 years. A very strong parentage, you're probably looking at return ratios improving from the 16.5% by close to 300 odd bips over the next 2 to 3 years. And again, I think in terms of dividend yield, a 1% dividend yield. So I think this space is looking very, very interesting over the next 2 years. My own sense is that the earnings momentum can be extremely strong for companies operating within this segment, at least for the next 6 to 8 quarters.
All right, Mayuresh, that's the view coming in. And thank you very much for the points that you made and the market reading on this. But we slip into a short break here. When we come back, we talk about more news and stock-specific actions, specifically around the tire stocks. And they have been rallying in trade. And we'll get you what's the reason behind this rally. Stay tuned.